My name is Maelvi Nunez, and this is U.S. Intervention in Central America. The 1980s Sanctuary Movement, prepared as part of the class Intro to Chicanx Latinx Histories, History 17CH, at the Claremont Colleges. The U.S. Central American Sanctuary Movement of the 1980s, more widely known as the Sanctuary Movement, was brought forward by American religious groups, churches, and political activism from both students and academics who rose in solidarity with Central Americans fleeing violence and repression in El Salvador, Nicaragua, and Guatemala. As the Nicaraguan Revolution ruptured and civil wars in Guatemala and El Salvador escalated, thousands of Central Americans traveled north through Mexico to the U.S. in hopes of securing political asylum. As Central Americans arrived at the U.S. border, the U.S. made the case that Central Americans were not true political refugees, but economic migrants fleeing poverty. By labeling them economic migrants, the U.S. was not only able to deny Central Americans asylum, but also deem them as quote-unquote illegal, and as such, they were subject to deportation. In response to this, over 140 churches and synagogues provided shelter to Central American refugees. By providing shelter to Central Americans, the movement came in direct confrontation with the U.S. government. The movement, or more so churches, not only challenged immigration policies in the U.S. by quote-unquote illegally harboring Central Americans and keeping them from being deported, but it also brought to light the role the U.S. played in supporting repression in Central America. To begin understanding Guatemala, El Salvador, and Nicaragua as the source of refugee migration, we must first understand the Cold War between the U.S. and Central America in the 1980s. Much of the violence and repression in Central America was actually caused by U.S. efforts to maintain control over countries like Nicaragua. In fact, during the Reagan administration alone, the U.S. government poured billions of dollars into Central America to help the military defeat social and revolutionary movements who sought to address inequality and poverty in Central America. In El Salvador and Guatemala, the U.S. helped fund and support dictators and death squads who tortured and killed thousands of civilians. While in Nicaragua, it helped fund the Contra War against the Sandinistas. The Sandinistas were the only democratic socialist government to defeat U.S. control in Central America. The rise of the Sandinistas came as an economic and political threat to the U.S. government, and in hopes of overthrowing their social movement, the U.S. funded right-wing rebel groups known as the Contras to counterattack the Sandinistas. Through these conflicts, we can see how U.S.-funded violence resulted in the displacement, torture, and or death of thousands of Central Americans. In many ways, the Sanctuary Movement gives us insight into the reality of U.S. intervention in Central America. To begin, it helps us understand that the U.S. is not the benevolent, caring for all, land of the immigrants, as it has been believed to be. U.S. intervention has not helped improve conditions in third world countries. Instead, it has only furthered conflicts and violence by arming and training the killers of innocent people, and then hypocritically deeming it criminal to shelter and aid the victims of those slaughters. Take for example the account of Ana, one of many political refugees from Guatemala who was able to find sanctuary in the Central Presbyterian Church in Massillon, Ohio. Ana left Guatemala fearing persecution from the Guatemalan government, who had accused her of being a quote-unquote communist because she was a member of the Catholic Church. Even after escaping repression in Guatemala and making her way to the U.S., Ana and her two-month-old child were arrested by Immigration and Naturalization Services agents, who were not much different from the Guatemalan government official she was fleeing from. While in custody, she underwent a series of interrogations and after the immigration agents became aware that she knew her rights, they, quote, were so mad that I knew my rights, so they started to threaten me by taking my child away. I knew I had the right to remain silent and make one phone call, so I told them I was not going to respond and that I wanted to make a phone call. They never allowed me to do so. End quote. The immigration agents knew Anna would not break so easily, so they resorted to something quite unexpected. They brought in a Central American, who to Anna looked very much like a military official, as his drab, olive-green uniform, quote, wasn't the uniform worn by the immigration agents, end quote. As the unidentified official began to interrogate her, Anna became, quote, very scared because the situation reminded me of what was happening in Guatemala. There were moments when I thought he was going to torture me, end quote. Stories like that of Anna help us to not only better understand the relationship between the U.S. government and the oppressive governments in Central America, but they also show us how the conditions influenced by U.S. intervention in these countries played a huge role in pushing Central Americans out of their countries. The majority did not choose to leave their home countries nor families. However, conditions back home left them no choice but to seek shelter in a society that actively neglected them as human beings. Their survival depended on their successful journey north and, if they were lucky enough, finding sanctuary. Even today, there are thousands of Central Americans hoping to escape violence back home, especially unaccompanied children, for even the tiniest glimpse of a better life in the U.S. A life with no fear where their lives will be respected and protected. And so the real question is, when will this cycle of violence end? There is no easy answer to that. Thank you for watching.